बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अनदर टाइप ऑफ कोवलेंट बॉन्ड विच इज़ नोन एज पोलर एंड नॉन पोलर कोवलेंट बॉन्ड। इट इज़ वेरी क्वाइट ईजी टॉपिक रिगार्डिंग कोवलेंट बॉन्ड टाइप्स एंड इट हैज़ जस्ट फ्यू पॉइंट्स विच यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड इन इट। नाउ लेट्स स्टार्ट फ्रॉम नॉन पोलर एंड पोलर बॉन्ड्स। Firstly, I will explain to all of you that what is non-polar covalent bonds, and then we will move towards polar bonds. Okay? So, coming towards non-polar bonds, we can say the definition of non-polar covalent bond. It is also written in your book as well, and it states that when two similar atoms, I am just writing some points. When two similar atoms means homo atoms. Homo means same. Okay? Form a bond. This is known as a non-polar bond. Like A and A are forming a bond in between these two. The bond is non-polar covalent bond. Non-polar covalent bond. And A is showing that these are homo atoms. Okay, why this bond is known as non-polar bond? Because the electronegativity of both are same. No one is going to repel and no one is going to attract each other. So there is no difference between electronegativities, and the bond formed between two atoms, two similar atoms, is known as non-polar covalent bond. Clear? Now, coming towards the other one, that what is polar? Obviously, name is indicating the polar bonds are formed always between two different kind of atoms. Now, if two different atoms, it is known as hetero. When the bond formation is between hetero atoms, the bond form is known as polar bond. Let's say it is A and here is another atom B. So the bond in between them is formed known as polar covalent bond. Why polar covalent bond? Because the electronegativity of A is different from B, and among these two, one will tend to repel or attract more towards each other. That's why there is a polarity difference creates. Okay? Polarity difference creates, and this bond is known as polar bond. Okay, polarity word is derived from polar, and one bonded pair of electron tends attracted more towards the other due to the electronegativity. Only over here the factor is included is due to their electronegativity, that which atom is going to be more electronegative and which will achieve partial negative or partial positive charge, upon which whole polar covalent bond depends. Okay, now in your book there is proper definition and there are examples. Now if we see the example of this non-polar covalent bond, the example you can quote is between same atoms, that is HH hydrogen, chlorine, because both have same charge, they will never ever try to they will never ever try to more strongly attract the other electrons, so there is no polarity over there. Now if you see towards polar atoms, the examples can be hydrogen chloride, it can be ammonia, and so many examples are over there in which electronegativity difference will show that this one is more polar and this one is more non-polar. The definitions are written on page number 64 and you can learn it by heart, and you have to mention the examples just like this, and you can also show more better way in a precise way grammatically that these are hetero atoms, these are homo atoms, these are examples, then you easily get the full mark. Okay, now coming towards another point in polar and non-polar covalent bond, that is the example of polar bond. Let's explain it. Okay, so we can say that the unequal sharing of electrons of bonded pair of electrons, it will form polar covalent bond. Definitely, when there is an unequal sharing of electrons in different atoms, so there is a difference between electronegativity is increased and hence a polar covalent bond is formed. Now, coming towards the example of H and Cl, hydrogen chloride, HCl. There is a bond between hydrogen and chloride, and hydrogen has partial positive and chlorine has partial negative charge. So there is a difference between these two electronegativities, and the difference between electronegativities of hydrogen and chlorine is 1. This is the difference on the base of which we decided that either the bond is going to be ionic or either the bond is going to be covalent. Remember, the difference between electronegativity shows that it is either ionic bond or it is going to be covalent bond. Okay, as the electronegativity of chlorine is more, that's why it attracts the shared pair of electrons towards with a greater force, because it has more valence electrons, it has more tendency, that's why it attains partial negative charge and it creates polarity in the bond. That's why the bond between this one is known as polar covalent bond. And what is the reason? This chlorine is the reason for creating this polar covalent bond. Okay, now in your book it is shown that this is hydrogen, the reaction having one electron, and this is chlorine, more precisely 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and here it's 7. To complete its octet, it will take one electron from hydrogen, and the resultant is like this. If you have learned the previous topics, you will definitely remember that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, here one of hydrogen and the other one, it is completed is octet by taking one electron from hydrogen. So what happened? As a result, it got partial negative. This sign is known as partial, and it will go partial positive charge. Now you can say that there is an electronegativity difference, and it is, you have to remember the values, it is of 2.2, and here electronegativity is of chlorine is 3.2. So the difference between two comes 1. Okay, electronegativity of hydrogen is 2.2, it is a calculated value, and of chlorine is 3.2, and when we find out the difference between two while becoming a bond, it comes 1. Okay, the delta, this sign, it is also known as partial, and most probably it is known as delta. The delta sign indicates partial positive or partial negative charge that is developed due to, I have told you, unequal sharing of electrons of bonded pair of electrons. Okay, the compounds resulting, those compounds which are formed just like HCl, are known as polar compounds. Okay, the compounds which are formed due to unequal sharing of electrons of bonded pair of electrons is known as polar compounds. Now there are few examples which we can see from your book as well. These are of water, H, O, and H. Now hydrogen is always positive, electropositive, and over here oxygen is electronegative. Another example of hydrogen and fluoride. Fluoride is a member of halogen, and it always contains partial negative charge, because halogen series always partial negative charge, and it has the more tendency to form bonds. And similarly, the same example which we have discussed later, it is partial negative and it is partial positive. Fluorine, chlorine, the series, remember, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, all these are halogens, and they are more electronegative than any other element. That's why they have the more tendency to attract the electrons and form polar compounds. Okay, water, hydrogen fluoride and hydrogen chloride. These partial or delta signs are really very important to show an polar and non-polar covalent bonds. Clear? Now, coming towards that we was discussing, I have already told you that it is basically the difference between electronegativity of elements that shows predominantly it is ionic bond or it is going to be covalent bond. Okay, now from the electronegativity value you can interpret that by electronegativity values you decided either the bond is going to be ionic or the other one is covalently. Okay, now see what happens. Basically this interpretation says that when high electronegativity that includes halogen, that just I have told you halogen group, bromine, chlorine, fluorine, iodine, this one, then there is low electronegativity elements that are alkali metals. Hydrogen is an example. And then when what happens, this is going to form ionic bond. It will be ionic in nature. Why? Because we have already discussed in ionic bond that why it is ionic when low and electronegative alkali atom metals and group 17 elements are going to be form complete transfer of electrons and ionic bond is formed. It is just reunion of ionic bond and ionic bond is formed. Now we was talking about the comparable electronegativity. It says that when electronegativity is more than 1.7, the bond is definitely going to be ionic bond. Okay, these are the calculations basically which have already been done. And it says that when electronegativity is less than 1.7, that is a standard value, the bond is going to be predominantly covalent bond. So by making the marking the difference between electronegativities between two bonds which are going to be formed, we can easily interpret either the bond is going to be ionic or it is going to be covalent. Electronegativity is more than 1.7, it is ionic, and if it is less than 1.7, it is going to be covalent bond. Okay students, now this was all for polar and non-polar covalent bonds. Now coming towards another bond, that is the last form of bond, and it is really very easy to understand the bond, that is also known as metallic bond. Okay, this is the last type of covalent bond which we are going to explain. The name is metallic bond. It is on page number 65. Okay, now first of all you have to describe that what is metallic bone. As the name is indicated, if you clearly see the name, there are so many meanings within the name or title. Okay, so over here metallic bone, the metallic bone, you can say it is defined as a bone formed between metal atoms that are positively charged. In my previous chapter I have told you that always metal atoms should be positively charged ions due to mobile means a thing which is in motion, or free electrons is known as metallic bond. Okay, a bond that is formed between metal atoms are always having positively charged ions, like sodium, potassium, these all are having positively charged ions, like sodium, potassium, these are metals and these are having positively charged ions. Okay, so we can say it is a bond formed between metal atoms due to mobile or free electrons. free electrons are present when they are isolated, then there are so many free electrons in a metal. So before going on that, we have to discuss some important properties of metals that are important properties that are, number one, you should all of know that these are having high melting points and boiling points. Another property is that they are very good conductors of heat and electricity. And they are very hard, obviously, and of heavy nature. Other than that, they form chemical bonds between different atoms. Means they have much tendency to form chemical bonds with the other atoms. These are very important properties of metals, and you should keep this thing in your mind that while discussing metallic bonds, you have to first discuss the properties of metal. Now, this is an important question, and it has been coming from the last years, as it has been come in 2017, and the question was that what is metallic bone, and write down some important properties of metals. Now, you can see in your book, page number 66, there is a diagram. Let me show you. Here it is, diagram, and you can see that, let me clear it. Okay, a schematic diagram of copper wire showing its positive nuclei embedded. Embedded means lipte hona, emerge hona, in sea of free electrons. The free electrons is zero, and it is showing like this. These are positively charged metal ions, and these are the free electrons making metallic bonding. So the bonding between copper wire is showing just like this. These plus signs are metal items, and these dotted are free electrons, in which they are embedded. They jakde hue hain aapas mein, means you can say. Okay, so this one is known as metallic bond, and you can learn it from your book as well. And this was all for today, and I hope you are practicing more and more. And if you have any question, you can simply ask on WhatsApp, and I will inshallah answer your queries. Till then, stay safe. Allah Hafiz.